Hi everyone, this is GKCS. Today we are going to be talking about a very useful method of authentication and that's called OAuth, which is Open Authorization. As you see, authentication and authorization are not exactly the same, but by the end of this video, you'll know why they end up doing the same thing. So here's the example. You have a bunch of websites that you are a part of. This could be Google, Facebook, LinkedIn. Most of us are part of these websites. So remembering passwords for these websites is a challenge. Every time you go to a website and you're asked to sign up, the biggest hesitation that you have is, oh my God, I have to think of another password now. So some of the common solutions found around this is, hey, how about Chrome suggests you a difficult password? So you don't have to remember it. Chrome stores everything. You can also have an external password manager, which manages all of your passwords, especially around bank passwords. Maybe you trust a password manager more. But even this is not actually that good a solution, because eventually you end up having, let's say, 15, 20, 30 passwords that you have to either manage in a password manager or you have to remember mentally. And the problem is especially acute for a startup. A startup has to sign up users, has to onboard users. And with such hesitation towards creating a new username and password, you want something that leverages the existing infrastructure of Google or Facebook or LinkedIn to take away your sign up problems. Let's say you have a user who comes to you and says, I want to sign up. Instead of signing them up manually through a username and password, you instead say, hey, if you're a member of Google, which you probably are, why don't you give me your email address, which is registered on Google? And the user says, all right, if I don't have to remember my password and username ever again, I would give you my email and I will trust Google not to share any information, which is part of my Google account, that you don't deserve to see. At a high level, it would be like if someone asks me for my previous employment details and I tell them, instead of me furnishing them, why don't you go and talk to my previous employer? And then I trust my previous employer to not share my personal details like payslips or, you know, my performance reviews. So just like that, we actually take this request of login to Google. So Google internally checks whether this user exists in its database. If they do, Google then goes back to the user and says, look, there's this new website, this startup interview ready. It wants to see what your real name is. Should I allow it? Now you say, yeah, sure, go ahead. They just want to see my real name. I'm ready to give that. So Google then returns, okay, their real name is GKCS. Now, as interview ready, what does this information tell me? It tells me that you're a registered person at Google and your registered email ID is some Gmail ID which you gave me. So I have your email ID. I have your name, and I know that you're a verified user by Google because Google verifies all the email addresses. So most of my job is done. I don't really need your password. The next time you come, I'll do the same thing. I'll go to Google, ask, you know, there's this person with this email ID who claims to be your user. Why don't you go and check with them whether they really are your user? So interview ready now has a new user entry with username, no password, but user profile details. Now we go back to the user and say that we have verified you through Google. And so here's a session token, which you can use for the rest of your session. So all subsequent actions from this user will use this session token. Tomorrow, if you want to revoke access from interview ready and say that, no, interview ready has done something shady, we need to immediately stop access. Google is going to say that that token is now invalid. So interview ready will no longer have access to your name. In case of name, it's like harmless, but let's say you gave permissions for your Google calendar and we are able to set events. If you see something shady and you go and tell Google, stop allowing access for Google calendar, interview ready cannot make updates to your calendar. So in this way, your data is protected, your services are protected, your Google services, while you are able to give the minimum information that is needed for interview ready to work. Finally, if you want to log out of this website, Google doesn't need to know about it. The website itself manages the logout and the login. The only thing that has been outsourced is the registration. So here's a war story which happened in March 2022. We were having roughly 50 signups per day in my startup interview ready. And what we realized is most of the users who were dropping off were mobile users. And apart from that, you know, they were going through the page, they were looking at things. And when it came to sign up, many people were dropping off. So how do you make the sign up page more appealing was one of the things that we thought. And that's where OAuth came in as a solution. We implemented OAuth and deployed it on the 15th of March. You can see that the numbers before that were around 50 per day. And this is what happened. Signups exploded. right? You can see on 15th March, they became almost 2x the number of signups we had earlier. We also heavily promoted the website just after that, which shot up our numbers. But when it gradually came down to normal, it was still much, much higher than what it was. You can see in April, which is the worst month, we were still doing far better than we were doing in the start of March in terms of signups. And primarily, this is because users were finding it much easier to just click on a few buttons and enter the website. In our experience, implementing OAuth was a one-time effort, one-time investment. If you want to implement OAuth for one system like Google, it will take you some effort. But if you want to add LinkedIn or Facebook or any other kind of OAuth, the flow is pretty much the same. So it's not much harder to add an OAuth flow after that. Also, the benefit is that you don't need to do user verification anymore. You don't have to verify their email addresses because you just offloaded that verification flow to these popular websites which have done it for you. Finally, you don't have to maintain their passwords. In case a person comes after a year and has completely forgotten the password, instead of them resetting their password, they're just going to click on a few buttons and again go into the website. The only drawback that we have seen with OAuth in a practical standpoint is that sometimes people sign in on Google through a different Gmail account and they have created an account already at Interview Ready through a different Gmail account. So what happens is they say, hey, I purchased the course. I don't have access to the course anymore. So can you check? And then we, you know, see that it's come from a different email address. So then we can connect with them and tell them, you know, are you the same person because your invoice email is something else? So that's a bit of a manual reconciliation, but it's totally worth the increased signups. Awesome. So what are the advantages of having OAuth in your system? One of the things is you have now completely outsourced the implementation of OAuth, whether it's testing, coding, debugging, you know, in general, there is some maintenance, some feature you want to add. All of that has been given to Google or given to Meta. You might want LinkedIn based on what kind of platform you're creating. One of the things is if you're creating a platform for software engineers, maybe you want to give them GitHub access. But if you're creating a platform for designers, maybe you want to give them Adobe access. So the vendor who you go to for OAuth changes depending on the product. The second thing is this is standardized behavior. OAuth is a protocol. So you will do things in a particular way. So your implementation becomes a little straightforward. You don't have to think of, oh, how am I going to salt and pepper this password? How am I going to store this password in a safe, secure way? All of that is already handled, again, outsourced. It's standardized behavior. You can expect certain things to happen. The third is the biggest product benefit, easy user onboarding. We'll take a small what story at the end to explain this even more. But the idea is that users find much easier to just use existing accounts instead of creating a new account on your website. Another major benefit that OAuth offers is mobile device signups. This is not something that the specification or the protocol does by itself, but it's a very big side effect because when people are on the mobile, they do not want to type in username and password. They just want to click and sign in. So any mechanism which does that, one of them is OAuth, really helps the user get onboarded quickly. And finally, there's possibly deeper user insights. This is a bit shady, but if you want to know a lot about your user, then one of the things you can do is you can ask a lot of permissions while sending the authorization request to the user. And if they give you the permission, then you have access to a lot of their information, like who are they, access to their calendar, access to their photos, possibly. So if you need more information, you can do this. But if you're caught while you're trying to take more information than you really need, that's a really bad user experience. They're probably going to run in the opposite direction. What are the potential drawbacks here? One of the things as a business is you have absolutely no control. So if, let's say Google is having an outage, then you are having an outage. If Meta is having an outage or LinkedIn is having an outage in their auth systems, you cannot have users signing up to your website. Okay, that's a pretty big problem. The second thing is you have very little flexibility. If you want to ask for more data or less data, you better hope that that platform contains it. If they don't contain it, you could separately ask the user, but then the whole signup process becomes long anyway. So you might as well have them entering their username and password and getting all of the data in one place. Finally, if the platform, let's say LinkedIn, says that, no, you are a shady website, I'm not going to be allowing you to hit my APIs anymore, then you have no reconciliation. You can talk to the website and say that, I'm sorry, can you please let me access the rest of the users? But they could just refuse. It's a private company, there's not much you can do. You can take them to court, but then you're losing users. while this is happening. The second major drawback of this is user data is often shared. So let's say you provide a particular service to your users who log in. 2 days later, they get to see ads from all your competitors. Why? Because Google sees that this person went and visited this website. They also logged in. Now, if we show them ads of a competitor, it's possible that they'll go and purchase that product. So there is data sharing, which as a business, you may not want to do. The second thing is the customer may not want their data to be shared. Maybe they don't want to see ads. Maybe they don't want Google to know about their interview preparation or about their personal life. So that really can't be avoided because of course Google knows, okay, if you're going to be using OAuth. And the final major drawback here is that you have very little signup control. You can have a potential loss of user data. Let's say I have a Google account and I log into your website. 2 days later, the Google account is deleted. Okay, now how do I log into your website? How do you know it's me? Right, I have no access to that email and there's no other way. I don't have a password that I can tell you that, hey, it's just me. So I have to either manually connect with your support team and convince you somehow that yes, it was me, or I need some mechanism to reset the password. Maybe through my cell phone, I can share an OTP with you, which will bring in two-factor authentication again so that I don't lose access to my product and you don't lose access to your customer. So that's it for open authorization called OAuth. Its most common use case is authentication, which is checking if a user is who they claim to be. And the strange way it does it is through authorization. Hey, give me your name. Oh, you gave me the name. That means you are a user of that website. I think it's a net positive because it's easier now for startups to onboard new customers. There are some drawbacks, but as a startup or as a medium-sized company, maybe that's not something which is very big for you. Thank you for watching. If you have any doubts or suggestions, you can leave them in the comments below. If you like this video, then please feel free to hit the like button. And if you want notifications for further videos like this, hit the subscribe button. I'll see you next time. Take care. Also, if you're looking for more detailed videos on distributed systems, I have these set of videos already created. And if you're ready, I'll just explain what they do. And then, you know, if it's relevant to you, you can go ahead. And these are all paid videos. So it's worth the investment if you're currently working in an organization. So one is the basics of distributed system security, verification, authentication, authorization. What are these terms actually? What do they really mean? Then comes the first type of authentication mechanism, which is token-based authentication. After that, we go for SSO and OAuth. OAuth is, like I said, authorization, which means you have been given the permission to do something. And authentication means you are who you claim to be. Okay, they are different concepts, but in security, sometimes they get mixed up. I mean, if you are being given to do something, then I already know who you are, right? So that's described more in detail in these videos. A single sign-on is something which your company probably does. If you're a large organization, you'll have your own @companyname.com.io. And the benefit of single sign-on is that your company owns your membership. You are a resource for the company, and that resource has been given access to a particular, let's say, course or a particular product. Okay, so as long as you have their email ID, the authentication happens on their side. This is described more with detail and animations in these videos. There's something called access control lists and rule engines. Very, very important concept if you're looking at very large distributed systems. For example, Google Zanzibar, which is Google's authentication system, it has now been open sourced, uses access control lists and rule engines. There's also AWS, which at scale has to handle security groups and various other problems. So that again is a variation of this solution. You also have a general concept of hackers or let's say malicious or not very careful developers who could bring your system down, and DDoS attacks, which you have to guard against in general. So those attack vectors have been described in this chapter. One interesting practical question which is asked often is how would you protect the videos that you have in a CDN? For example, if Netflix has a bunch of videos which are all copyright, then you know, how do you stop a user from just going and downloading the resource from their browser, as long as they have the token? So what kind of security mechanism would you put in there? Or even for a live video, like let's say Hotstar is broadcasting a cricket match. At that time, what if you take your token and share it with all your friends? what happens then? So this has been tackled to some extent. It's not a full DRM solution, right? I'm not talking about how do you ensure that nobody copies the original video and shares it with friends. That would be a digital rights management question. This is more of a security mechanism that you are going to stop malicious or unauthorized users from accessing the resource. After the resource is accessed, anything can happen. That is described over here. And finally, there's a quiz just to make sure that you actually understood the concepts that were explained. So this is a pretty useful chapter. It's one of the chapters in Interview Ready. We have more than 20 now. 21 is coming up on Friday, which is on distributed consensus, Paxos. So I just wanted to, you know, keep you guys in the loop. There's more than 220 videos right now on system design at Interview Ready. So recently there's been a lot of new videos which have been added. Like I said, purchase it only if you're currently working as SD1 or above. If you're an intern or if you are in college, these videos are not what you want to invest in right now. Watch the free YouTube videos. You're doing great. And if you're currently working, yeah, I mean, it makes sense for you to invest in more depth and concise set of resources. Thank you so much for watching this. I'll see you next time. Take care.